Clear, bubbling, and lively waters, like those of the source of the Cuervo River in the province of Cuenca, already constitute an unusual spectacle. Living waters have their specific inhabitants. Among them, perhaps the most striking, is this bird with a white chest, known as the white-throated dipper. Also known as the European dipper, it thrives on the larvae of certain insects, such as mayflies, dragonflies, some small freshwater mollusks, armored larvae of coleoptera, larvae of the ferocious diving beetle, and those worms that protect themselves in tubes, also serving as juvenile forms of caddisflies and stoneflies. Pure waters sustain the life of this wondrous creature, which, despite its abilities for diving and swimming, belongs to the group of passerines, the common birds like sparrows or goldfinches. A bird that, without remarkable anatomical adaptations, is capable of diving, walking underwater, and swimming with great agility. It can exert these efforts in turbulent waters, in torrents, in waterfalls, in the few remaining places on our continent where living waters still flow. The birth of this beautiful river in Cuenca is evidently the most suitable setting for these creatures, which are specific to pure waters. The white-throated dipper is linked to unpolluted watercourses to such an extent that its presence can be considered the clearest symptom of a river being pure and alive. For this reason, obviously, there are fewer white-throated dippers on our continent every day. Unpolluted watercourses are so scarce. These magnificent corners of nature are becoming increasingly rare. We had to travel many kilometers of river stretches to find the nest and habitat of the cinclus cinclus. But this bird is not the only representative of these crystal clear waters. There is also a mammal, an extraordinary creature, whose habitat, truly minimal, extends from the Pyrenees to the center of the Iberian Peninsula. It undergoes an incredible process of ecological convergence with the white-throated dipper. It feeds on the same prey and is equipped, almost identically, with the same abilities. We are referring, dear friends, to the Pyrenean desmán. It is named as such because until recently it was thought to only inhabit Pyrenean rivers. It is a peculiar water mole. It belongs to the order Insectivora and the family Talpidae, but it spends its entire life in rushing, turbulent, crystal-clear, pure waters, capturing larvae of aquatic insects. The incredible Pyrenean desmán had never been filmed in nature before. These shots, friends of Iberian wildlife, are absolutely unprecedented. Perhaps the best way to present this creature, which appears as a mosaic made of pieces, with anatomical remnants of other mammals, with a small elephant-like trunk, with beaver-like skin, with batrachian limbs, is to showcase it during the moments that occupy most of its life. It has been observed that the Pyrenean desmán spends more than a third of its useful time preparing its epithelium, its fur, to waterproof it, and thus withstand the low temperatures that prevail in mountain rivers. This animal, which hides in moving waters, has rarely been seen and was only discovered by science less than a century ago. Now, as it meticulously grooms and combs its fur to waterproof it, we have the opportunity to marvel at its sight. But we intend to describe the biological cycles of both creatures specific to pure waters, the white-throated dipper and the Pyrenean desmán. We began, therefore, in early spring, trying to film the hidden nest of the white-throated dipper. This bird, astonishing in all its activities, constructs its nests in peculiar sites such as the underside of a dam. At the bottom of the dark tunnel, it has placed the nest where its chicks have come into the world. In spring, showers and downpours are frequent, representing a rapid rise in mountain rivers. Such an eventuality could be dramatic for the white-throated dippers, which place their nests on the banks if they were not perfectly adapted to these weather elements. The rising waters will have radically changed the characteristics of the entrance to our white-throated dipper's nest. We awaited with fear the outcome of the problem. Would the small bird be able to pass through the curtain of water? With absolute naturalness, as if it had been doing it all its life, the white-throated dipper penetrated its tunnel to feed its young. And after the flood, it went to look for the little animals that make up its diet. But the appropriate moment to search for the Pyrenean desmans is just after the storms. Nocturnal by nature, they tend to hunt during the day, however, when the waters become turbid and they can act on the surface, thanks to the fact that mosses, lichens, and grasses are very wet. After a minute of immersion, the Pyrenean desman surfaces. Its keen sense of smell will allow it to sniff among the moss. And its insatiable appetite, devouring 75% of its own weight daily, will lead it to hunt and capture any worm, crustacean, or insect within reach of its teeth. We observe the iridescence in the fur of the Pyrenean desman. It is nothing more than the grease produced by a gland located at the base of the tail, which perfectly waterproofs the fur. Awkward on land, the Pyrenean desman's front paws adapted for digging allow it to find its soft prey. While outside the water, the Pyrenean desman navigates through its exquisite sense of smell. Within the water, it relies on an extremely sensitive organ located at the tip of its trunk, known as the Eimer's organ. This delicate perception system allows the desman to function similarly to dolphins using echolocation. The slightest ripples in the water, produced precisely by the paddling of its front limbs, return in the form of aquatic echoes, the shapes and movements present in the desman-inhabited water. The vibrissae, which we can now see perfectly, that is, the long and sensitive hairs on the sides of the trunk, and at the base of the jaws, are also endowed with the finest sensitivity. Thanks to these elements, the desman can function perfectly in complete darkness. The eye is tiny, vision must be extremely reduced. The ears are blocked when the desman is submerged. The auditory scale of this primitive mammal must also be very small. Nevertheless, its agility for swimming is astonishing, and the immersion time, 1 minute, for a creature with such a high metabolism, is prodigious. Pyrenean desmans are tremendously unsocial animals. Rarely do they come into contact. And precisely in spring, from the month of February, the mating rituals take place. The approach between males and females. We have the privilege of witnessing the violence of these loving encounters between Pyrenean desmans. The male fishes eagerly amidst rejection and rejection from his presumed girlfriend. And both partners thoroughly inform themselves through smell of who is who. It is a competitor, a potential enemy, or a possible husband. It has been observed that outside of mating seasons, male Pyrenean desmans have killed and partially devoured females. This aggression of the desman towards members of its own species can be explained by the fact that it is an untiring predator that meticulously exploits its hunting territory, ranging from 200 meters to a kilometer of river. There is virtually no stone, no corner, that the desman does not explore to find the enormous amount of food it needs to maintain its thermoregulation and accelerated metabolism. However, it is a special scent emitted by the sexual glands of the female and male during mating season that serves as a pass for these primitive animals to mate. The courtship will continue until the male leads the female to an abandoned water vole burrow, where mating and the birth of the two or four offspring that make up the Pyrenean desman's litter will likely take place. Meanwhile, the white-throated dipper, also endowed with a highly elevated metabolism and needing to feed its three or four chicks, which sometimes reach up to six, continues to bring food to the nest located under the dam. We can perfectly see the chicks thanks to the light of our filming systems. However, the male and female white-throated dippers, when they enter the darkness, can locate the chicks thanks to the signaling effect provided by the inside of their beaks, by the oral mucosa, which has the same effect as the so-called reflex reflectors. As we can observe, white-throated dippers meticulously clean the nest and its surroundings. Meanwhile, spring is advancing in mountain rivers. And we are heading to the province of Guadalajara, specifically to the Dulce River. In this fresh and pure water course, we have the opportunity to discover another white-throated dipper nest. The chicks, now quite large, have likely spent close to 20 days inside the camouflaged bowl. Their parents can act so close to the nest that the chicks receive fishing lessons without venturing outside. Meticulously, the mother collects the tiniest aquatic insects, snails, and crustaceans, which she gathers along the shores or in the water. Feeding sessions are repeated with tremendous speed and with intervals of just a few minutes. The white-throated dipper nervously extracts the soft larva from its shell. And our cameras, strategically positioned within the riverbed, reveal the secret of this bird's fishing ability in the torrents and in the backwaters. This rapid feeding pace is responsible for the early development of the white-throated dipper chicks. It can be observed that external nests are much more enclosed than internal ones. And among the various nesting locations, whether behind curtains of water, inside crevices or caves, or on virtually bare walls like this one, it is precisely the exterior nests that are the most sheltered and simultaneously the best camouflaged. Before attending to the chicks, the white-throated dipper loads several larvae in its beak. But the Pyrenean desmans, not far from the nest of the white-throated dippers on the Dulcie River, have already completed their courtship displays and eagerly engage in fishing. They located their nest in an old water rat burrow, which unfortunately our cameras could not penetrate. However, we were able to observe the frenzied feeding activity of the Pyrenean desmond and its hunting techniques. We witnessed how it uses its trunk not only to sniff, but also to grasp the insect larvae that form the basis of its diet. We saw how these small creatures tirelessly explore every corner of the river, how they always go outside to feed. How they employ their hind limbs, perfectly webbed like swimming fins. How they dig and cling to the riverbanks with their sharp claws. How they incredibly gather the enormous amount of insects they need to survive in cold waters. Fortunately, for the Pyrenean desmans, in spring, caddisfly and stonefly larvae are so numerous that they form true banks in some mountain rivers. Clearly, the expenditure these creatures undergo with their swimming movements and territory exploration burns a huge amount of calories. Until now, zoologists had practically been unable to keep Pyrenean desmans alive in captivity, possibly because they lacked the necessary elements to feed them. Until now, not a single film had been made in nature of the Pyrenean desman. There were practically no photographs. And now we witness a proclamation of territorial rights by the male desmán. Through comical swimming activity, the Pyrenean desmán attempted to make itself visible to any competitor. But it returns to its incessant underwater exploration. It perfectly clings with its limbs to the stones, and it remains submerged for that long minute that allows it to hunt underwater. The once fierce desmans, now appeased by love, act together. After 20 days in the nest, we find the entire family of white-throated dippers from the Dulce River outside their dwelling. The chicks lack the striking plumage of the adults. They have overall brown tones. The white bib of their parents serves as a perfect location beacon in the dim light of mountain banks. It's like a target. Like a clear point of attraction that the chicks must follow in the turbulent mountain waters. And precisely for this reason, the white-throated dippers constantly flex their limbs. In this way, the pectoral beacon flashes, and the different members of the family are seen. It's incredible that tender little birds, barely larger than a sparrow, without webbed feet, without anatomical adaptations, can survive in this world of rivers and torrents. The enemies of the white-throated dippers are countless. Accidents in their environment are very likely. They truly learn to swim before they're able to fly, and they feed immediately after leaving the nest. But all these aspects of the white-throated dipper's biology will be precisely the subject of the next episode of the Iberian series of El Hombre y la Tierra. Thank you.